Naresh, present the instruments.
So Naresh, as we have decided, you will first tell all the equipments, name all the equipment which are usually required for rhinoplasty and their features, and then what is the purpose, and you may describe one of the procedure which you have read it or you are aware, then we can take some questions which are commonly asked related to this equipment. Okay, so you start.
The first instrument we are going to describe is a tudicum speculum. It has two flanges and a curved shaft. It is used for anterior rhinoscopy, foreign body removal, preoperative nasal packing, and in septal surgeries. Variation is St. Clair Thompson speculum, which have longer blades. Next slide, please. This is the way we hold the tudicum speculum with our index finger and the thumb over the curved surface, and we will close the blades with the middle finger and ring finger. Next slide, please. And this is the Killian nasal speculum, which have a shaft and a cone. It is usually 13 centimeter length. The variation is portal speculum, which is usually 14 centimeter length. The blade may be variable length, 30 millimeter to 90 millimeter, may be self-retaining with a locking screw, which should be tightened for holding the instrument, or non-self-retaining. Next slide, please. This is the variation between Killian speculum and the portal speculum. There is no angulation in Killian speculum, and there is angulation in the portal speculum. And next slide, please. A nasal retractor. What we are seeing is an off-reach retractor, which have an handle and a blade. It is used to lift the dorsal nasal skin during closed rhinoplasty. It can be used to gain exposure for placing malar implant to nasal approach. The modifications are with the suction tip with light source. Next slide, please. This is the way how we will insert the off-reach retractor holding the dorsal skin. Other retractors variations are Converse, Meliniac, and the Blue Burst. Converse and Meliniac have a handle over the upper end of the retractor, which can be the assistant can hold from the head end of the patient, and the grouper have a weight over the connected to the upper end, so it rules out the help of the assistant during the surgery. Next slide, please. Double hook. The double hook is having a handle with two blunt tip hooks. It is used to retract the intercartilaginous incision during rhinoplasty. Next slide, please. This is the way we load the alar with a double hook during intercartilaginous incision. Next slide, please. Next, mucoperiosteal elevator. The picture we are seeing is a Frias mucoperiosteal elevator. It is thin and long instrument with a small flattened blade at either end. The blade is straight at one end and curved at the other end. It's used for elevation of mucoperiosteal flap in septoplasty and submucous dissection. It's also used for separation of septal cartilage from bone during septoplasty. Next slide, please. These are the variations of mucoperiosteal elevators. The first one is Joseph elevator, Foreman elevator, and the last one is Cottle elevator. Next slide. And the Mitchell trimmer, this is also used for elevating mucoperiosteal flap. It was first used in dental department for the separation of cemento enamel junction. It is also used for mucoperiosteal F. That hook can be used for dissection of pedicle and palate surgery also. And the next one is Howard periosteal elevator, which have a one-end spatula style elevator other end flap right angle dissector. It is used for mucoperiosteal flap elevation and also as a periosteal elevator in maxillofacial surgery. Next slide, please. Nasal knife. This is what is in Ballinger's swivel knife, which have a handle and inch cutting edge. Is introduced to a small incision in the nasal septum. It is guided posteriorly towards the omur bone, followed by downward movement of swivel to cut the nasal septum along anterior angle of. Next slide, please. And nasal scissors. The first one is Joseph's scissor, which have both the outer and inner edges are sharp and pointed tip. It is good for dissection of the soft tissue from the pericardium. And Foreman scissor, it's an angled tip to improve visibility. Next slide, please. And the cotton scissor, it was further angulated to increase the visibility during dissection. And converse eyelid scissor, it's mainly invented for eyelid surgery, but due to the angle tip, it can be used in rhinoplasty also. Next slide, please. The cartilage scissor from other scissor have serrated edges in the margin of the blade, so it prevents cartilage from slipping during cutting. Next slide, please. And the Axon Brown cartilage holding forceps. It's have a non-toothed forceps with the horizontal serrations for atraumatic hold of the cartilage. Then next one is Cortal cartilage crusher. It's a rectangular solid box with a channel in middle and a solid lid that closes into the channel. It is used for compression and flattening of the cartilage before grafting. A mallet can be used to increase the force during crushing the cartilage. Next slide, please. This is Kaplan septal scissor. It's a double joint design to increase cutting power. It is used to cut the septal cartilage easily. Next slide, please. It is a Middleton Janssen septal forceps. It is a double action angled instrument with a oval cup shaped jaw. It's used for holding and removing the septal cartilage. Next slide, please. A rasp is used for leveling the nasal bone and removing the nasal lump. It's have serrations which can be horizontal or vertical. The nasal rasp can be upcutting or cross-cutting according to the serrations. Next slide, please. The first one is offish rasp, and the second one is cotton rasp. Both have a transverse serration. It can be both upcutting and downcutting. And the last one is Malt's rasp, which have vertical serrations and transverse serrations. Next slide is Cortal osteotome. It's have a bevel edge on both sides. It's ideal for performing sculpturing of a bone. It's a solid stainless steel shaft with a smooth inclining sharp blade tip. Its length is around 7 inch. It's a rounded corner and the blade have multiple markings which shows the depth of blade. During osteotomy, the markings is from 4 millimeter to 12 millimeter depth. Next slide, please. Next is Anderson's Neyberg osteotome. It is used for nasal bone osteotomy. It is a curved osteotome. It has a curved variety and a straight variety. Curved variety are the site specific. The concavity of the curve is upward and the guard on medial side inside the nasal cavity. Straight osteotome can be used in any site. And next one is silver osteotome. It can be curved ostate. And the figure is showing a curved osteotome on the left side and the straight osteotome. Next slide, routine osteostome. It's an anvil is used for controlled osteotomy. And the last one is obvagal nasal septum osteotome. It's used for disimpaction of septal cartilage during Lefort 1 osteotomy. Next slide, please. Next slide is chisel. Chisel is identified by bevel edges on one side only. It can be curved or straight. The number on the chisel indicates the size of the tip in millimeter. The picture we are seeing is a Friere's chisel, which has a straight shaft and a blade. Next slide, please. Next is gouges. Gouge is identified by the blue dent. The number indicates the size of the tip in millimeter. Next slide, please. This is a Killian gouge. It is a bayonet shape. Shaft is bent so that the tip lie on higher plane than the handle, so that while holding the Killian gouge, it will be the tip is visible. The tip is sharp and used in removing nasal spur and sharp projection during reduction rhinoplasty. Next slide, please. These are the variations of gouge. Agile gouge, which have a V-shaped tip, and the Friere's gouge with a rounded tip. Next slide, please. And the Tillis nasal packing forceps is used in packing and dressing, and it perform anterior nasal packing and to remove cartilage and bone piece during septoplasty. Next slide, please. It's a mallet. Mallet have a shaft and a head. It is used to give force during osteotomy and used with the chisel and osteotome and used for cartilage crushing. That's all. Thank you.
Okay, very good. So I think all other PGs must have noted down the series of equipment which are usually required for rhinoplasty. So henceforth, this PPT is very useful for all of you. Now, one of the equipment or set of the equipment may be given to you in your hand, and then examiner now can start asking the questions, which can be as simple as describe the steps of rhinoplasty. Now it is you have to decide whether for which indication you want to speak the steps, or otherwise examiner can also tell you, please tell the steps for hump reduction or augmentation or a post fracture deformity. Or so it means this is a possibility, and you must be mentally prepared that you should be able to tell the fundamental steps of the rhinoplasty. So I think you must have read it, because since you know that rhinoplasty, so which type of rhinoplasty steps you have read?
Open rhinoplasty.
Very good. So now once you say open rhinoplasty, then examiner can ask you open versus closed. So how you will decide when you should do open, when you should do closed, and what is endonasal? What is endonasal rhinoplasty? So endonasal is nothing. It is same as closed rhinoplasty. The terminology is only changed. So you must be aware of all those terminology which are used. What is pug nose? I mean, like that, there is unlimited viva questions will start. If you are able to tell all the equipments, name, and one standard procedure, probably you are through. Rest of the thing is all. What is pug nose?
Pug nose is there is a depressed.
Yes. So it is when the tip is lifted, dorsum is flat, like a bulldog. You know, bulldog, the yes, dog. So typically, it is compared with the saddle nose deformity. So examiner may not ask you directly saddle nose deformity correction steps. He may ask you like this. So this is the way you should be. But even if you don't know, it doesn't matter. These are the some difficult questions. Even if you, what post-op advice, suppose what you have done rhinoplasty, what post-op advice you give. So he wants to know whether, at least you have read it, tomorrow you are going to do, what advice you will give post-operatively, successfully you conducted.
We'll do acid packing and we will...
So suppose you have done the nasal packing and patient sneezing comes. So if you have not told the patient that you may get a sneezing, because there will be always a foreign body sensation, and patient sneeze, then what he should do?
He should
open the mouth.
Open the mouth.
In the open mouth, sneezing means you are reducing the pressure on the nasal side, and patient able to, because suddenly it will come and then the whole pack will come out, and then maybe if it is a immediate post op bleeding will also start, then panic reaction will be there. Then you have to give other advices, like patient should not wear a glass, because no nasal bridge is there, and on that you have to put a, suppose, POP or a splint. So he should not use tight clothes. Why tight clothes? Because suppose he has to remove the shirt. Every time he remove the shirt, it may touch the splint and it may cause the... So, I mean, these are the various practical questions which may examiner ask you, so that tomorrow he wants to know, okay, theoretically you have understood the steps, but practically, are you aware of no? Then what is nose job?
Nose. Any
functions, pardon? Of nose.
Nose job. Nose job. So any rhinoplasty is called nose job. So don't get confused. Simple. I mean, any rhinoplasty, which is, you are saying, patient will say, doctor, I want my nose job. Now, which part of the nose, which indication is there, that is different. I think now it is 7:30 almost. We have spent more than 25 minutes on this. So there are many questions which even Dr. Atul can ask, so that you can note down. You may not answer now, but please note down. Dr. Atul, you want to ask some questions which are important for them?
Yeah. There are a lot of questions, but the point here is that this is one set of instruments, the rhinoplasty set of instruments is. That examiner is not going to ask you the detailed use of that particular instrument. He is only going to ask you the name. Then he is going to move on to the steps of rhinoplasty. So what I can advise you is, you should know the name of the instruments, and then you should know the steps in detail, and the differences between open and closed, which plane do you dissect. And only instrument which can be asked in particular is that the osteotome, the guarded osteotome which is there. What is the purpose of guard? And how do you know the osteotomy is being complete now? Mm-hmm. So all these questions can be asked, but most of the rhinoplasty related instruments, you will be asked the procedure. As opposed to the palate, you may not be asked the procedure, but the detail of the instrument. As opposed to the grafting handle, where you will ask the details of the grafting handle. So rhinoplasty, mm-hmm. You will be asked the procedure. You should be sure of that.
Okay, I think we can go to the next equipment.
Yeah, I think we should move to the next set of Lakshmi.